All right. Have you hit record? All right. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Heidi. Thanks for joining on a Friday afternoon and very busy grant writing season, I know, but hopefully this will give you a little boost on how to polish up your proposal. I know some of you are nearly done. It takes so long to get through your review process. Just as a reminder, this file and several files came out to you on the program manager's listserv. That includes the budget workbooks and statements of assurance, etc. If you need anything resent, we'd be happy to do it. The grants are due May 24th, no later than 4. We're asking for an original and two paper copies, so no electronic copies yet. Let's make sure we are receiving from you your final before we ask for an electronic copy. So paper copies for now, original and two paper copies mailed to the address below, to be received no later than 4 on May 24th. This is our third and final year of our grant period, so I'll let you infer what that means. This grant application, very, very similar to last year's. Very few changes. The director's memos that have come out were added in. But otherwise, very few changes. So this should feel familiar. However, please do not just copy and paste from last year. We'd like to use this opportunity to help you polish up and give a little more grant writing feedback than we've been able to do in the past. So for example, this year we're going to be providing you written feedback on these proposals. They may not come out instantaneously, but we will provide written feedback. We heard that complaint, or the request, I guess, from some folks that without getting written feedback on each proposal, they really had no feeling for how their narrative was received. So we will address that this year and be providing written feedback in a way that is constructive to your grant writing. We recognize that our good friend Vicki used to hold a grant workshop regularly in the spring, and because she has retired, was not able to do that this year, but VALRC was so clever, they were able to get her recorded, and she did a sort of a mock grant writing workshop in December, and those videos are almost ready to be shared. I'd like to unmute Kate Rolander and have her tell you the kinds of grant writing workshop tools that have been produced and will be coming out to you.
So, hi, can you hear me? This is Kate.
Yes. Yes.
Great, yay. So we, as Heidi said, we filmed and immortalized Vicki in a workshop video in December 2018 with some program managers around the state. And we have turned that workshop into 5 self-paced and self-contained grant writing workshop modules. So they'll, by the time we send out the webinar archive, we should be able to send out links to those. We're working on edits to the very final one with the videographer today. So that will be available soon on our website, and we'll send out a specific link. But here are the 5 modules, and each one we say maybe allow for an hour to go through it. They'll have videos, handouts, and activities, each one that will help with specific sections and aspects of the AFLA grant. So module 1 is mechanics of grant writing. The second one, and again, you can choose to do one or all of them in whatever order makes sense to you. The second one is outcomes and impact. Then the third module would be need statement, capacity, and commitment. The fourth one focuses on goals and objectives and is a really meaty one that has a lot of examples of good SMART goals and SMART objectives. And the final module is on program design, activities, the budget narrative and the budget workbook, and then last but very not least, evaluation. So if you have any questions about these modules and accessing them, please contact either me or Joanne at the Resource Center and we'll make sure you have what you need. I think that's it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Kate. Can you put the titles of those modules in the chat?
Yeah, I'll do that right now.
All right. Thank you. So we hope those will be useful to you, not only this spring, but next year as well. Someone asked if we've got slides. We do not have slides today. We're just going through the grant application. So let's get into that. Scrolling down your budget estimates, same as always. I'll just pause here for a minute. Your region, fiscal agent, your enrollment target, your total AFLA federal allocation. Remember, you, the little asterisk here, you have to subtract from this your correctional and institutional amount. And you have to use you have to be consistent in your budget workbook so that you're writing your CNI application to the amount you have subtracted from your full AFLA budget. Conversely, you have to write to the amount of AFLA dollars that are left once you have subtracted the CNI amount. The next column is GAE. The second to the last column is SLCA. And the final column on the right is your total estimated allocation. Should anything change, we'll let you know. We don't expect changes in those amounts. Let me pause there for a second. Does anyone have any questions about, let me get to the asterisk right there, about this asterisk? You can put it in the chat or unmute yourselves. Last year we did have some folks who wrote their AFLA budget for the full amount and then asked for another bunch of money for the CNI, and that's not how it works. That total AFLA column represents your total amount. It's up to you to subtract the amount you plan to spend on CNI. All right. Seeing no questions yet. I'll keep going. Those are all the same. So let's start on page 7. 17 looks the same. Cover sheet, that's the same. This does not count in your page limit. This page would not count in your page limit. In this box here, where I am right now, amount requested for program year, this is where you will put a number that's less than your total AFLA allocation. Because this will be for your AFLA, Section 231 activities. The cover page for your CNI will have an amount here for the CNI activities. The two numbers together would equal the total AFLA allocation. We leave it to you to designate an amount up to 20% for CNI. All right, so I'm gonna start with some tips and some of our vision. What are we looking for in these applications? Given the page limit, what are we looking for? As you know, we had a data leader training 2 months ago in March, And we talked about the role of data not being the same thing as design. So what is program design and what are we looking for in program design? In this section, and if you've already written it, please think about going back and looking at what you've written to see if it addresses what I'm about to say. I want you to articulate how your program creates and connects to career pathways for all learners. Not just that you serve anyone who walks in, but how have you designed your program? What are the various paths that students can take through your program? All of these paths should be conceived as a career pathway. Everyone in our program should be on a career pathway, wherever they are and whatever that means to them. We need to know that our work, our federally funded AFLA programs are creating career pathways. We did the Wizard webinar 2 weeks ago, and we talked about even getting every one of your students on Virginia Wizard would be a step in that direction. Getting people to think about careers, becoming more aware of careers, that's the start. Think about how you work with your literacy councils and partners called different things in different places, but the volunteer literacy organizations. If some of your students are being served in those organizations, then maybe you should make that relationship more formal so that those are your students. The language of AFLA in WIOA is very strongly worded that we are to serve individuals with low levels of literacy, not just refer them to someone else. So if in your region you have had a relationship of referral, that's fine if those referrals are happening to programs that are supported, that have trained individuals, where those students feel that they are part of your program too. That you are serving, you are making sure that they are getting services. It can be strong referral networks, it can be a vendor relationship where you actually have an MOU and a contract with the Literacy Council that's happening in several places around the Commonwealth. Those, you don't want to be referring away and not getting those student hours. You do want those students as part of your program, and you want to treat them like all other students, that they are on a career pathway. If you have programming with partners, such as your literacy councils, describe that here in program design. I realize you're going to have to be concise, so it's a challenge. But we do want to know if you are sharing students, if you have partnered in order to provide that career pathway in various localities or across your region. Letters of support from those programs are always welcome. Letters of support would be the final appendix that you would attach, and it's out. They are outside of the page limit. Consider adding IETs if you haven't tried an IET yet. This would be a good year to try it. We'll be able to give you lots of technical assistance. We can talk to you over the next couple weeks as this application is coming in. You can get it fairly well planned, but not down to the every detail. And we'll come back and we'll redo and update your integrated education and training planning tool. If this is your first time, I'd really encourage you to try it this year if you haven't yet. Try and get something going I think the way of the world is we're going to want to see IETs more prevalently offered around the state. One idea to start kind of close to home, a low threshold start idea, might be to work with your local school divisions. Find out from your superintendent or the neighboring superintendent what positions they're having trouble filling. And what are they going to train, what kind of positions are they going to train for this summer? Are they going to do a bunch of training for cafeteria workers? Are they herding for bus drivers? Do they have janitorial or maintenance positions that go unfilled that they could do training, on-the-job training? Is there anything close to home, for those of you who haven't tried IET yet, that would fit in your vision here to get started on an IET? I said every student should be on a career path. Certainly not every student would be in an IET, but we'd like students to know that they're available in their region, that it's something to strive for, something that's possible. If you want to talk to me more about working with your school division, shoot an email. We're taking all questions around the grant to OAEL and getting those answered and compiling them. But I'd like you to think about, if you don't have an IET going yet, this is a good year to try. We can offer a lot of assistance this year. Next year, we will not be able to offer so much assistance during grant writing. So thinking about design, tell us how you're going to serve students, not just what you will do, but how you are designing the program so that students will feel that they're on a career pathway, so that students' learning will be accelerated, so that students will understand that there is training available. Maybe you've incorporated some transition workshops. I got someone from the college coming to help with post-secondary transition. That's what goes into this design section. I'm going to jump down for a minute because I want to make the point that the design section is not the same thing as the GEPA. The GEPA we talked about for the first time last year because the federal office first asked for it last year. This is a one-pager. It's outside of the page limits because it's an appendix. Many of your fiscal agents already have a GEPA statement. So be sure and check to see if there is something standard that should be going into this grant from your fiscal agent. I think a lot of the community colleges have GEPA statements. This is where the organization will say, we do not discriminate, we serve all students, we make ourselves available, we provide accommodations. All of that kind of language, that goes in the GEPA statement. That doesn't need to go in the design statement. The design statement is about programming. How are you going to set up program paths for students with various needs? The design that you have for your very high level pre-GED students who are going through HSE programming, high level of standards, that may be a more accelerated path than the path you set up for folks who are beginning in their English language learning. But those are programming designs, and that's what you need to describe in design. Any questions about design? All right. Let's go to data and performance. We'll jump back to budget. you know what, I jumped over goals and objectives. I was not supposed to jump over goals and objectives. Let's go back. Goals and objectives. All right, so when you wrote your first grant, you were asked to write goals and objectives for all 3 years. Last year, we gave you the opportunity to update your second year goals. Many of you updated some or all of your goals. Same thing here. You have the opportunity to update what you had said and contextualize it a little bit for the reality that you're facing now. Maybe you have a new partner, maybe you have a new idea. If you don't need to update something, you don't need to restate it. Some of those goals and objectives take up quite a bit of space. But you can use this space to articulate how you are meeting your stated goals. What we're really looking for is the progress toward achieving them, which is this part of it. That's what we really want to see. How are you making progress towards your goals? And how are we supposed to know that? Think about the reviewers. Cite your evidence. Don't just say you're doing something. Tell reviewers how. What data do you have to back it up? What can you point to that you've done that shows that you're making progress? So cite your evidence and answer reviewers' questions like, show me, prove it, how? These are the kinds of little comments that reviewers write in the margins as they read a grant. Show me, how? You have to think as a reviewer when you're writing, and that's hard. And if you can set it aside for a day and get a clear head and then come back to it, try and read it like a reviewer and have a colleague read it like a reviewer. Are you making broad statements that are unsupported? What can you put in there to support your statement? How many graduates have you had? New partners that have been formed that are starting to offer services? How are you meeting your goals? And be specific in citing the progress that you have made. I'm sorry, I skipped over that when I started. Do you have questions about goals, writing the goals and objectives part? Katie Irby, I'll wait for you. You can unmute yourself. I think you can unmute yourself, Katie.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, hi.
Hi.
All right. So last year, I had all of my goals included. So for example, I did 3 career pathways, 1 for each year. Mm-hmm. So for my first one, I updated with numbers as far as completers. And if I met that goal, mm-hmm. Or really it was my objective, but anyhow, and so for the second year, don't you want to see if that was met?
Mm-hmm. I do. I want to see your progress. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what do I need to do as far as for the first objective? So like, my goal was to implement 3 career pathways. So for the first year, it was with truck driving, second year CNA, third year, whatever. Mm-hmm. So do I need to put anything for my first one? Because you already know how that went based on last year.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yes, yes. I think because you have very limited space, I think you should focus on telling us about the progress you achieved in last year, because last year's application should have told us about the progress you were achieving in the year that
right.
it ended.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to have to keep doing progress.
Okay. Got it?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
You're welcome, but don't lose track of that first year. You know, hold that file someplace because when you write some other grant, you will want to demonstrate all of your progress when you have enough room to do so.
Right, okay.
Katie and Buffy are getting double dose of grant writing today. The three of us were on the RSVP technical assistance webinar today, and these same kinds of concepts were coming out loud and clear to the community colleges about that grant too. So congratulations to those of you who are in a region that has an RSVP grant awarded, and to those of you who are not, there may be another attempt being made. So nice to see Katie and Buffy see you again this afternoon. So that's goals and objectives. Focus on progress from last year. Thank you for that clarification. You have an opportunity to make adjustments if you've got a new, you know, new opportunity to do something in the coming year. We want to know about that. Don't stick with what you wrote in 2017. If life has changed so much, you want to jump at a new opportunity. So then I talked about program design. I'm looking to see what you're planning in order to help students advance and get on a career pathway, get on with some training, get on into further education, employment, and training. Let's go down to data. In this section, last year, I think it was an underutilized opportunity for you to tell us how you are leading your region in high quality data and meeting your targets. There seem to have been a common theme in your applications that you were telling us that you were doing what we asked you to do. But we expect you to do that. That's the baseline, that's the minimum, right? You have to do some of those things. You have to use SSWS, you have to put in attendance, you have to collect an ASPD from each student. Be very brief as you say that, because we expect that. That's the bare minimum. If you're getting funded by us, you need to be doing that. What you need to use this space for is to tell us how you're going to meet your measurable skill gain targets, and if you have areas of weakness, how you are going to improve. Talk to us about some of the new data policies and how you have trained all your folks, how you are ahead of the new requirements, that you understand and what this will mean, what you're trying to do around data and performance, not just the bare minimum. You don't need to put in your NRS tables because we have that information. Really, tell us what you're going to do. Not give us data that we can, we already have at our fingertips. But what do you plan to do? How do you plan to improve the performance in your region? Either your MSG rates, or your post-test rate, or your credentialing rate, or your data security, or your data integrity. How are you improving performance? Making sure everyone understands the requirement to track attendance by the day, right? In order to fulfill the requirements for periods of participation for POPs. We need to know, you know, that you are leading the charge in your region around these new data requirements. Any questions on that section? Does that make sense? You guys aren't talking to us very much. I'm hoping that what I'm saying is helping the wheels to turn, and you can go back and strike out some language that you had from last year that was maybe too general, too vague. Maybe use this time to, this opportunity, this continuation award, to be more specific, to try and articulate how you are being a leader in each of these areas. All right, thanks, Katie. Let's go back up to budgets. All of this is same language from last year. One thing that we consistently have back and forth on with you is that the budget narrative doesn't always match the budget. And I understand in grant writing, things get out of sync. One set of writers is writing the narrative and having ideas, and somebody else is trying to write the budget and keep up with all of these moving ideas, and they don't always work in sync, right? But reviewers see them together. We need to be able to read your narrative and look at your budget workbook and look at the schedule of Appendix D and say, oh, they've got 20 classes. I'm making this up. They've got 20 classes meeting for 10 weeks. Here's that calculation. Instead of trying to figure out, the budget narrative says 18 classes, the scheduled classes says 20, the budget itself is unclear. Those three things need to triangulate. When you're done writing your narrative, you really need to stop and look again at the budget workbook and at the schedule of deliverables. Those three things need to be in alignment, because the reviewers look at that. That is a place that we really see a lot of challenge, and we have a lot of back and forth about it. So if you could spend more time making sure that what you say in the narrative matches what you have in the budget workbook, that will save all of us a lot of time. I want to remind us that all professional development costs, it doesn't matter who is attending, but all professional development costs should be covered under the administration funds. Okay, not under instructional funds. Instructional funds can cover professional learning communities. And we've been very flexible with what those topics can be. When there are colleagues working together, co-planning, examining a topic together, we're likely to see it as you do as a PLC, and allow that to be just instructional time for instructors. But professional development, when people are leaving the area, leaving the classroom and going to professional development, all of those costs need to go in admin. And I want to emphasize that again, because the Sector Strategy and Career Pathways Academy invites went out. I hope that all regions have received an invitation. And if we haven't caught you in the May invitations, we'll catch you in the September invitations. There will be in-person, what they're calling foundation courses, followed by online coursework and peer work groups. Every region should have somebody who goes all the way through that experience and can represent adult education all the way through that experience, be that colleague. I'm calling it badged, like we're a badge. because you earn badges as you go through the online classes. And you come out at the end with a certificate. You have earned a certificate in the Sector Strategy and Career Pathways Academy. We'd like someone from every region to plan to earn that certificate. So for budgeting purposes, that goes in the admin. It doesn't have to be program managers. It can be, and you very well might want to be that person to understand that online, that professional development that's being offered across agencies. It could be a regional specialist. It could be a career navigator. Someone who has responsibility around your region should be that person going through and getting the certificate in Sector Strategies and Career Pathways. And you should budget for about 30 hours for that certificate. If that puts you over your 5%, that is a valid reason to request a waiver. The other things that go in admin that are going to strain your budget, all professional development, as I just said, including the 30 hours for at least one person to go through the certificate program, and any contribution you must make to your local workforce center. All of those things must come out of admin. And if that adds up to more than 5%, that's okay. Be effective and efficient with it, but send a letter with your application requesting a waiver to the 5%, describing what exactly is in it that makes you go over. But especially that Sector Strategies, Career Pathways, the requirement from the state that adult education participate, that's a very valid reason. And also your infrastructure costs are a very valid reason to go over the 5%. Other questions on that? Anybody have questions on the sector strategies? Everybody knows what I'm talking about there? All right, thank you, Nicole. The sector strategy, be local or travel cost, the project divided the state into six regions. Those six regions don't align with anybody else's regions, but they just kind of found six areas that they would lump together for these in-person foundation courses. So there will be some local travel, unless it's the foundation course is offered right in your town. And that is the only part that is in person, is the foundations course. So there will be a little bit of local travel for that. It's a 6-hour foundations course, so only one day. There will not be an overnight required. Nope, that's how they planned it. Nothing else on that kind of new requirement I'm tossing your way. Mostly I've been very pleased and grateful for your enthusiastic response to those invitations. So I appreciate it. I hope you have a great time. I hope you meet colleagues and dream up some wonderful career pathways for our learners. While we're talking about professional development, I want to give you a preview. The other state fund grant applications are moving through the department toward release. That includes Race to GED, Plugged in Virginia, and the ISAP secondary program. In the Race to GED proposals, there has always been a line that said you may use these funds for professional development. Sue Mansfield and I, Sue's on today, Sue Mansfield and I put that in bold italics this year, just so that you will really see that. You really must be using some of that Raise to GED money for professional development for your instructors. That is an excellent source of funding to bring VALRC down, to do a regional standards-based workshop, or send some of your people to a standards-based workshop. That's what that funding source is for, is to improve the rigor of your instruction. And we do that not only through outreach, which is the sometimes that's our biggest cost and expenditure in Raise to GED, but not only in outreach, but in investing in your teachers and in instructional learning, instructional materials. So as you're thinking about professional development, do hold that thought until the Raise to GED proposal comes out, because I think you will have a new way to think about where you can put some of that funding. Do you have any questions on that? All right, one other set of things I wanted to talk about. So this one page guidance on completing your narrative, same for all three grants, just about the same, but of course in CNI, let's get down there. You will be talking about how you're serving individuals who are incarcerated or re-entering society. Some of you have had great success with parole and probation, re-entry councils. Others of you have longstanding programs in regional jails. That's where you're talking about your designing here. These students also should be on a career pathway. More than ever, they need a credential. So if you can think about expanding your IETs into this population, into an occupation that they will be eligible to be hired in, that would be great. They really struggle with getting a family-sustaining job once they are released. And then IELCE, similar. Here, you are going to take into account, I'm on the cover page here, you're going to take into account the number of individuals you plan to serve, because there is performance-based funding for IELCE. And that chart is on page 5. Let's see if I can get back there without making you all dizzy. Let's see. Close your eyes a minute. There. Okay. Table 2 on page 5. How many students are you projecting to serve in a qualifying IET? This performance-based funding is only available in IELCE awards, by the way. Maybe something we need to think about, but we know this is a challenging model to help individuals who are learning English to get all the way through a credential test. And so this performance-based funding is here for you and should reflect your realistic projected estimate of individuals completing an IET. All right, I'm gonna scroll back down, so don't look, it makes you dizzy. Okay. So remember, in IET, you're going to be serving those English language learners who are eligible under Section 243, which includes foreign professionals. We've started this process of helping you recruit from that population. And let's just keep going, hoping that the word will get out in the community. You know, we know that word of mouth is probably our best way to reach all of our subpopulations. So the more you do, the more the communities will understand that they can come to you for integrated education and training and get launched into a career. Of course, all IELCEs must submit their integrated education and training planning tools. Those are appendices and are outside of the page limits. Make sure you are taking the tool from this link, that you're using the most up-to-date tool, the one that is posted on the website. And if you don't know every single section right now, give us a hint when you think you'll be able to complete that section, because we will be coming back to get an updated planning tool from you after funding. Let's push on to fulfilling that requirement that we place students in employment this year. You guys have done a great job with exposing students to jobs. Just coming back from the national meeting of state directors, I'm really proud to represent our work in IET across the whole program. A lot of folks are still really struggling, but you really know what you're doing. And I know it's difficult. So we really applaud your efforts on that. I wanted to say a couple other things. One is I would be remiss if I had all of you on the line and didn't say something about XPRIZE. Here we are, it's May. XPRIZE is running April 1 to August 31. Our goal is to get 5,000 students to download and use one of the four XPRIZE apps. We certainly serve that many students. We should be able to do it. And it doesn't have to be just students. You can give a charge to your students and say, go help us get five other people in your community to download and use these apps. They need to be used on three different days in order to count. We had a webinar with Learning Upgrade last Monday. They are making a very generous offer to all the states that are participating in XPRIZE. They are making their entire curriculum from literacy through HSE available for free for folks who get started during the XPRIZE. So this is Learning Upgrade and Cell Ed are two apps that were approved in April as distance education curriculum. So you could get people started now before classes are over, get them going, and get make sure you understand how to track them. I think you need to follow the link on the Learning Upgrade page. It was all explained in the webinar how to do that. Get an additional two or three numerals into the code that they use when they download their Learning Upgrade, and set them loose over the summer to continue their education and get hours. You know, our summer break is somewhat forced by our fiscal agents and the timing of the grants and the grant award notifications, but learning should happen around the calendar, right? So can we set folks up in distance education and then let them work over times when we have to take a break? they still have their phone going, so why not get them started on that? And that helps us with the XPRIZE too. If you're going to talk about that in your program design, talk about how you're thinking that distance education is going to be part of your design. What does this do for you? What does this do for your learners? How does this help you keep people on a pathway? And Karen put a link to the XPRIZE apps, thank you, on the VALRC site. Also, there have been articles in Progress Newsletter with lots of detail about how to get started in XPRIZE. So it's Learning Upgrade and Cell Ed were both approved for distance education hours. Hoping that you all can send your students loose for the summer with something in their pocket besides just a phone they use for Facebook. I want to see some of these questions for each and every class. The question from Rachel is, do we need to have a planning tool for each and every class, or do we have one tool for each individual industry? So I'm assuming this is an IET planning tool, and if you are running multiple cohorts on the same model for which the grid and the shared learning objectives and the employer partners would be the same for multiple cohorts, then you can put multiple cohorts on a single planning tool, IET planning tool. But if that's not true, if you've got cohorts that go at different paces, have different employers, have different training partners, then you would have to have multiple tools. Rebecca asked about career and training services identified. So thank you. We do have a director's memo on career and training services. There's a little video tutorial. Both of those things are on the professional development page of the VDOE adult ed site. We want to see percentage or absolute value. We'll take it either way. We just need to know that you are planning a certain percentage of your career navigator will be spending time with students as career services. That kind of a position, if someone is a full-time career navigator, might be 100% as a career and training services. If you know you're planning an IET with 10 individuals for whom you expect 5 may not get funded through WIOA Title I, and you may need to pick up the tab for their tuition, then you would put 5 amounts of whatever the tuition is as a training cost that you're estimating. If you are providing, the initial assessments, remember it's initial only, initial assessments are considered career services. Your cost of doing intake. So look back at that director's memo that is career services. I'm going to slip it over here to Karen in a minute so she can type it in. And think about it. Feel free to ask more questions if you get in the middle of something and you're not sure. But I think it'll make sense now that you have gone through it once. You can do it either way, as a percent or as a total value. If you want to add a column over to the right, make sure you're way past the formulas. You don't want to mess up any of the formulas in the budget workbooks, but if it's easier to do it as an actual value, that would be fine too. What comes in the budget workbook is an estimate. What we're really going to be looking at with you is the actuals that come in at the end of the year. You've hopefully been keeping up your career and training services workbook, and we'll have a total, an actual total for us at the end of the year. Other questions? Do feel free to talk to us, you know, use the code of according to memo number, if you're trying to talk about a topic that's long and complicated. Some of our data memos, the data dictionary, etc., can be shortened in your narrative by telling us which memo you're referencing. Karen, the career and training services memo is highlighted here. If you can put in the number of it. The memos are on our resource page, memo 006-18. We've had some questions that have come in advance, and Rupal's reminding me, thank you. One question was a few examples of collaboration around distance learning. How could you collaborate to provide distance learning? You could be collaborating with libraries, with summer reading programs through the schools, churches, other places of worship, collaborating with each other. If some folks are in a region where one locality or one IELCE is going to keep running through July and another one is not, is there some support that you can sort of bend or share with each other? So collaborating to provide distance learning. Sometimes learners need a place to go to ask questions, but they're not close to where your program is over the summer. Can there be a toll-free number they could call? So those are some things that we have seen around collaboration and distance learning. And I'm sure I'm guilty of this again. The IELCE programs are not mandated to have relationships with the one-stop career work centers like the regional programs are, and are not required to contribute to the infrastructure cost of those career work centers as the AFLA program, 231 programs are required. So if there is some place where I have not included a parenthetical statement saying accept IELCE programs, I apologize. The IELCE programs do not have to contribute to the infrastructure cost of the Virginia Career Work Centers. The AFLA Section 231 programs must contribute. And it can be in kind. That's up to the regional negotiations, but the requirement for alignment and cooperation really falls most heavily to the Section 231 funded programs. So thank you for catching that again. I'm guilty of calling you all regional program managers. Are there other questions? In the webinar that VCCS ran today for the RSVP grantees, there was a nice slide of tips, grant writing tips, and I took a picture of it while it was on my screen. So I'll just share that some of those with you. I thought they were spot on. So tip one is Assume the reader is not familiar with your industry and the programs you discuss. Make sure you're writing for a reviewer. I used to always say, would my mother understand it? She's a very good reader. Have I given enough context for someone completely unused to my day-to-day vocabulary? Have I given enough context that that person could read it and understand it? The next tip is like that too. If you're going to use an acronym, make sure that at first appearance it's spelled out, okay? Unless it's an acronym that's here in the application. If the grantor, us, if VDOE, there's an acronym for you, is using acronym, then you can feel safe to use it too. But if it's an acronym unique to you, then you need to spell it out for us. Provide enough detail for the reviewer to know what's being proposed so the reviewers are not filling in the gaps with assumptions. And that's just protecting yourself. You don't know what a reviewer is going to assume that you're doing. Make sure your objectives and proposed outcomes make logical sense with what you are proposing. So again, that's that internal alignment. Are your goals and objectives being addressed by your design? Are they being supported by your budget narrative and your budget? Can we connect the dots through your application and draw a line from what you propose to do to how you're doing it to how you've budgeted to do it? And that's just something you can use as a review. If you can set the application aside for a day and come back fresh, read it again and see if you can draw that line from what you propose to do and your objectives through to the language and the design section. Find that in the budget. Does it make a complete picture? I already gave you this tip of making sure your budget numbers match the budget narrative. Make sure that's true. Just get somebody to go back one more time. I know it's a moving target. You make a lot of changes as you write a grant. But just go back and make sure that at the end, before you submit, those things line up. And then make certain that assertions are supported. So if you're saying you're doing something and that you have been doing it, you should be able to say what the outcomes are. Support what you're saying. Cite your evidence. It's what we tell our students all the time. Cite your evidence. Think about it as part of monitoring. This is part of the process. When we come out to monitor, we do read your applications before we come and put sticky notes all over it saying, is this really happening? Is this happening? Show us where this is happening. The application really starts the monitoring process. Someone is losing the link, so that's unfortunate, but we have this recorded. So we will be producing a recording. Any other questions while we're together? May 24th is your due date. The state grants are in review, as I said. They should be coming very shortly. Luke is asking about the tables in NRS. The tables, the current tables are still in development, Luke. So if you want to use numbers from last year, pull those numbers. You can check with us, but the tables right now are in process for this particular year. All right, well, if you have further questions, and we'll compile our questions and answers today and what we've received in the OAEL box, further questions come to oael@doe.virginia.gov. That way we keep a running list and can create an FAQ that we send out to everybody. We appreciate your time today and all the work that you're doing. We know you're heading toward the end of the school year, and so there's a lot going on. We look forward to reading your applications. Thanks, everybody.